For the latest film interviews, reviews and everything making news in pop culture, subscribe to Film Companion now.
Lots of times our meeting point when I'm staying at her place is in the kitchen at night, both of us coming for a midnight snack.
Yeah. You know, at the dinner table, we're very well behaved. But when we meet in the kitchen in the night, we're foraging for food for a midnight snack. That's where the best conversations happen.
There was a baby burp and Harun can burp at will like Coco. And so I said...
Family secrets that you're giving out, Mama.
I know.
Aparna and Kongna, so lovely to have you on Film Companion. Firstly, big congratulations on The Rapist premiering at the Busan International Film Festival. It's a very complex film, very layered film. I have so many questions. You kept us sort of shifting our sympathies throughout that movie. I didn't know what I myself was feeling while I was watching it. And I want to begin by asking, Aparna, that you had this idea, the germ of this idea, many, many years ago. So why did it take so long to make this film?
Well, there were other films that I wanted to make. I mean, not any particular reason. I hadn't really fleshed out the story. Then I told the story to another guy, a very good lyricist who writes in Urdu and Bangla, called Srijato. And he was deeply moved and he kept saying, Rinaldi, you must make this film. You must make this film. So Chanda came to Calcutta, I mean, she just descended upon me asking if I have any story ideas from Quest. So Chanda of Quest. So I was just hunting around in my mind and then this story came to mind. And I told her and she loved it. And then she took it to Applause and they loved it. So it was then greenlit.
Kongna, your character is grappling with just very complex moral choices, right? As a woman, did you debate these choices at all? Did you debate with Aparna whether this character would or would not do this?
You know, my mom and I mean, I'm used to hearing lots of story ideas from my mom. I mean, since I was a kid and often, you know, at an early stage of its inception, etc. And we constantly have discussions, big and small, you know. I mean, that's an ongoing process, I think. Naina, I have to say, Naina's character in The Rapist was one of the most difficult characters really to understand, because it's not even like, it's not a very distinct kind of personality in the sense that it's not like she's situated very specifically separate from me in a cultural, geographical or social context. She's very much like, you know, we're kind of in a similar zone, in a similar world, but these things happen to her. And, I don't think I approached it as whether I agree with her or not, or whether I would have made the same choices or not. But my struggle was always to understand whatever choices she had made, you know, just to understand her.
Tell me, this is the third film that the two of you are making together. After Mr. and Mrs. Iyer, 15 Park Avenue.
We made two more films together, but Bengali, one was Bengali. And the other one was in Hindi, but it was, you can see it on Z5. It was from a play by Badal Sarkar.
Recently we did that film and there was also Goynar Baksho, which is...
Goynar Baksho is the
house.
It's comedy.
Five films together.
Yes.
Wow. So tell me, this actor-director relationship, how has this evolved, especially since Kongkana, you've become a director yourself?
Why you want to take that first?
Me? Well, yeah. Kongkona, really, I have to say, she really didn't don her director's cap while we were working. But on days when she found me very tired, and she knows that I'm very, very particular usually, you know, very finicky, very a bit of a perfectionist and so on. When she found that I was not, I was too tired to pay attention, she would sometimes quietly whisper in my ear, "Ma, you know, don't you think they should put some more medicines and stuff on the bedside table. Yeah, and I felt terrible. I said, "Oh my God, how did I miss that?" But it was because it was very exhausting finishing this in 27 days. We finished it.
You finished it 2 days ahead of schedule.
Yes,
that's unbelievable. That is amazing. So, yeah. Were you like leading lady and sort of slight AD?
You know, I don't think so. Firstly, I like to think of myself as like part of the crew on the films that I act in as well. I don't know if the crew members would agree, but I like to think of myself like that. And also because I'm primarily an actor and I've acted for, you know, 20 years and 50 films. So I think primarily I think like an actor. Like in my early films, sometimes, you know, I would be a little more involved, like, oh, why are they doing this? They should not do this. This should be done, etc. But I slowly learned to become more and more detached. So most of our discussions or things like that would have happened, you know, prior to being on the shooting floor. It's usually not at the time of shoot that anything major is really being discussed. And, you know, I'm familiar with the style that Ma works in. And one, as an actor, one has worked with so many different directors and everyone has their own style, you know. And so I don't have one particular way that I have to work or anything. I'm usually, I would like to think, that fairly adaptable to this kind of stuff. So I don't actually don a director's cap at all. I mean, I've only directed the one feature, so I have no business to be doing that anyway.
I don't do that either. Even now when I'm acting, I don't usually. I put my director's cap away.
And you can compartmentalize like that.
Yeah, but actually when I was an actor in my youth, I used to do much more directing. Really, there were times, there are very funny stories which I will write in my memoirs someday, but sometimes, yeah, and my elder daughter Pomuli said, Ma came back and she's looking very tired, and she said, what did you do, Ma? How was your day? Oh, I first went there, then I dressed up the set, then I rewrote the script, then I acted, because I used to often find, for instance, when I wanted to do some business, like, you know, putting something away in a cupboard, suddenly I find that the cupboard door won't open, you know, because that's the way it's been made. These are the little lessons I learned. I said, when I'm making a film, the cupboard doors will open, because the actors should be able to do their business with ease, you know. Konkona gave me actually some very good suggestions, which I can't say without giving away the story, which I did incorporate.
So you're shooting this on location 27 days in Delhi, just before the second wave of COVID hits. That's incredible. How challenging was that? Like, what are the kind of things you both were up against?
It was very challenging, but I think that, you know, this is before we had any knowledge of the second wave, right? So for us and for everybody around, it was really a sense of things becoming better and things slowly easing up, because this must have been Feb, March. So it was, we just kind of squeaked by, you know, right before the second wave. I think the day we came back to Bombay, I think the curfew started the next day or something like that.
I returned to Calcutta on the 6th of April, and 8th of April, the lockdown started in Delhi.
Tell me, Konkona, I remember many, many years ago when Shekhar Kapoor's Bandit Queen released, I remember Renu Saluja, the great editor, telling me that, you know, when she edited that sequence where, you know, Pulan is lying in that shed and the door is just closing and opening because more and more men are walking in to rape her. She said, like, it kept her up at night. She said, I couldn't sleep just from the horror of that situation. Are you able to disconnect as an actor, or did playing Naina sort of, you know, work on your mind as well?
So I think that what happened is that we had a lot of prep. We did, you know, these extended workshops with this fantastic person, Kanishka, I think, from Atul Monge's team. And we had a lot of, like, Ma read the script and we had a lot of discussions and all of that beforehand. So at that time, it was on my mind a lot. You know, I found, and I've done quite a few intense roles, you know, through the course, you know, of my work. But this was definitely up there. I think that, you know, when you're shooting, it's not, with me personally, when you're shooting it, it doesn't have that kind of an effect. It's only when you watch it in totality, or you're watching it, you know, kind of you're working on it, you're watching it, or you're writing it. And I think that that's the time when it affects you the most. Because when you're shooting, at least for me, the process of shooting is so kind of, you know, fragmented. Yeah. It's so chaotic that it's, you know, you're just imagining most of the things half the time, because it's just like, you know, like a really chaotic set around you. You're shooting little bits, like a little bit in the beginning and a little bit in the end. So you are never creating a complete experience. And some sequences were tougher than others. Many times that would be because of, you know, when I had to, you know, for example, when I'm lying on the ground on the field outside, a lot of it is just because it's dark, there are mosquitoes, it's cold, you know, so there are so many other things as well that, you know, you are not actually experiencing it as a finished product.
Yeah.
Which when she was writing, when, you know, even when I've written things or when mom was writing it or when we were reading it, you know, as a whole, she would have these narrations and then we would have discussions or during the workshops, we're just in that reality kind of focused in a focused way for many days. At that time, it had much more of an impact on me where I would maybe, you know, think about it, but not really luckily, I think, during shoot. And very rarely has that happened, actually.
And what are the two of you like on a set? Are there ever arguments? Does that ever happen, or you're both very professional?
This time,
though, well, of course we are.
Which we are, yeah. Also, we, you know, there is this instinctive understanding of one another. As I was saying, because I brought her up, and she's been with me for the longest time, and. You know, half the time before I've said something, she understands what I'm trying to say. And then there are times when I get terribly inarticulate on the set, you know, because I'm an actor and I'm not being able to explain the nuance of something, you know, how to go about doing something. And then I, as a last resort, I sometimes demonstrate. But Coco has learned not to imitate me, but to take the essence out of it. You know what I mean? It must be difficult for some other actors. And I tell them, don't imitate me, but just try and understand what I'm trying to do. You know, and I think, and Arjun, I have to tell you, I was so pleasantly surprised because, you know, his gorgeous looks, I can think, take away from the fact that underneath there is a very finely tuned actor.
Yeah.
And, you know, he tends to underact, which was perfect for Aftab's role.
Yeah.
In the one scene, I think, that he completely loses control, it becomes that much more effective because he's so understated.
Yeah. Then, you know, Kongra, you in Death in the Ganj also looked at masculinity and how these very narrow definitions of what it is to be a man is brutalizing not just for women, but for men also. Is that just a coincidence? Do both of you, or is it something that the two of you respond to as storytellers?
You know, I actually had not set out to make a film on toxic masculinity. So I had not articulated in my head what exactly I had to do. It's just that I knew I had to present this story and this is the world around us. It is the world.
Yeah.
You know, whether we, so, and I wanted to just depict that world that he exists in. Shutu exists in that world, so I wanted to honestly depict it. And that, you know, I mean, that is what is toxic masculinity. I hadn't meant to deal with depression or masculinity as such. I was told a little bit in the beginning that how come the protagonist is not female? But then again, that's, you know, we should really stop telling female filmmakers what to do and what to write. And also, if the problem is coming, you know, from men, then they need to be examined further. I felt, you know, because 99% of all violent crimes are committed by men. You know, more men die by suicide than women, etc., and all of that. So I had not meant to start out like that. But, you know, I think Ma and I also have a shared world view, shared experiences. In fact, you were asking earlier about how we are on set. I think that, you know, we understand each other's signals quite well. So I know when, you know, she's really tired or when she's really exasperated. So I'll kind of, you know, try to be more supportive. Or I know that, you know, today it's kind of, okay, I can tease her a little bit. You know, and I can get away with a little bit of, you know, something or the other. I can tell. Sometimes we communicate on the monitor, but I know she's looking at me. So I'm just like, you know, I want to eat or something. And she's like, Coco, you know, so it's that kind of fun thing also happens.
And remember on the last day of the shoot, I kept falling asleep over the monitor. And she's, it was the last day of the shoot. And she kept, and she was not there that day. But she stayed on just because of me. She said, I said, it'll be all night long, Mama. She said, never mind, I'm staying. And then she kept shaking me. Mama, wake up. You haven't really seen this shot.
Because the, you know, it was taking so long to set up, and we were all, I mean, people much all like half my mom's age, you know, we were all just dying and collapsing. And I could make out that she's so tired and she's so particular usually that I was just like, you know, come on, we have to just push through for this.
Yeah.
She was, many times she was in a wheelchair. Not because she had some pain in her knees. No, not because of anything else. But just because there were such long walks, even from the hotel lobby to our room. You know, the van to the shooting spot. So many times, like, she would be on a wheelchair.
You know what happened in the last film, in my last film, Bengali film, I broke my kneecap. I mean, cracked my kneecap.
And shot through it.
Sitting on a wheelchair. And then ruined my back. So I have some knee problems as a result and some problems. But, you know, so they would, and I was having a lot of back problems, constantly sitting and not going for walks, not being able to do my yoga in the morning because there's no time and so on.
So, all the pain medication.
Yeah, and the pain medications that I was taking. And then I went to a physiotherapist, you know, all these things. And so there was a time when, you know, when I had to walk long distances, sometimes I would be wheeled there, but it was really very uncomfortable because I would just go bumpity-bump, bumpity-bump.
I read an interview that Sameer Nair, who heads Applause, did. And he said, Aparna, the best thing about you is that you made these wonderful films and won innumerable awards, but you never say, when I did this, when I did that. He said, that is the most amazing thing about her, because that's the thing to do. You do amazing work and you leave it behind and move on. How do you manage this?
Zen and the art of archery. Lovely book. You throw an arrow and then you forget about it and you move on. No, it's not that. It's just that when I'm making this one particular film, I'm not thinking of other films. You know, and when...
What he was saying was, just in a normal interaction, you know, somebody with your body of work would say, oh, but when I did that, or when I, you know, but you have no sort of, you're never referencing your glorious past. You're just focused on what you're doing now.
I don't see it as a glorious past to start with. Awards are all very well. But most of the time when I see the films, I can only see mistakes. Unless it's a very long way away. And then I say, oh, that's not bad. You know? I don't see it as a very glorious thing. Half the time I see my career as grappling for funds. You know, where am I going to get funding? But because one of the things that I am proud of that I will tell you about myself is that despite the kind of films that I've chosen the kind of stories that I've chosen to tell, despite that, I have been able to make films and continue to make my kind of films for 40 years. And very few people, a lot of people would have given up because it's tough.
It is tough.
I'm not saying the shooting is tough, that I enjoy, whether I'm tired, aching, whatever, I enjoy every second because that's a high that I cannot compare with any other high. You know, it's like an orgasmic high. So, but the thing is that before that, you know, all the stuff that you have to do, the people that you have to talk to and, you know, continuously negotiate about funds and so on and actors' dates and this and that, all that is horrible. And I'm concentrating on that. When am I talking about myself and what I did, when I did, I mean.
You know, I have to tell you about my mom. I don't think she realizes that she's quite a legend.
Are you kidding? Of course.
Yeah, no, I don't think she gets that.
Makes me feel really old, Coco.
She also has this amazing ability to be focused very much in the present and live in the present.
And that's so wonderful. That's just amazing. Genuinely.
Many of Coco's friends are my friends as well.
Tell me, going back to what the other legend, Shabana, said, that feminists are going to be really pissed off. Do you have any concerns about that at all? That it could be interpreted in many, many ways?
Yeah, I don't have I'm not concerned about that. I don't feel anxious about that, but I'll rather welcome it, because, you know, many of my questions will get answered in the process. I don't pretend to take sides. I don't try to give solutions in the film, because I don't know the solutions.
Yeah.
I don't know the solutions, you know. I don't know what the penalty for rape and murder should be. I only know that I personally am against the death penalty, even though sometimes when, you know, like this little Kashmiri girl, Afra, was killed, the Banjara girl or Nirbhaya, you know, at those times I felt these people have no right to live. But that's an emotional reaction. My intellectual reaction is not that, because the death penalty should not be a vengeance. It should be a corrective device. This is what I feel intellectually, but I can't stick to it all the time. There's a lot of ambivalence inside me. Yeah. Therefore, my ambivalence, I think, comes through in the film.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Okay, and last question, because I must know, what are your family dinners like? In my head, you're all looking sort of impossibly elegant and making highly intellectual conversation. Is this true, or do you guys get silly as well?
Of course we get silly.
That's
easy. Okay. Yeah. I have our meeting point, lots of times our meeting point when I'm staying at her place is in the kitchen at night, both of us coming for a midnight snack.
Yeah. You know, at the dinner table, we're very well behaved. But when we meet in the kitchen in the night, we're foraging for food for a midnight snack. That's where the best conversations happen.
Yeah. No. We play the fool a lot, and with Haroon, it's just wild.
My son, whose name is in the credits of the film, can you believe it? That's just adorable, because I think he was feeling a bit left out because everybody in the family was involved.
No. There was a baby burp, and Haroon can burp at will, like Coco. And so I said,
family secrets that you're giving out, Mama.
I know, and I can't burp at all. Sometimes I wish I could. So Haroon did a number of burps for us, and then we did a lot of things with the pitch and the volume and this and that. Anyway, so because he burped for us, and because he was feeling so terrible at having been left out of the film, when Coco and another girl who's like my adopted daughter, her adopted sister, Damini, who did the costumes for the whole film for the first time, and she did a great job.
Yeah.
Because Damini and Coco were both going and acting in Mamam's film. He calls me Mamam. And he was not, and he was very upset. He didn't like any of us.
Yeah, because we had all gone away to Delhi for a month, and he was here with his dad in Bombay. So he was just like, you know, the fine, then go away. And
okay, go. So good. I don't want to have anything to do with you, kind of thing.
Now he's made his burping debut.
Yes, he's made his burping debut, and you know, he's just there. Yes,
That is lovely. I cannot wait to see the responses to this movie, because I think those are going to be as interesting as the film itself. Thank you so much to both of you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anupama. Thank you.
If you like this video,
please subscribe to Film Companion.